What's good, y'all? It's the Dumachettes, Rhea, and we're back with another video. Who we got today, C?
Today, we're back with another American Reaction. Super excited about this video. If you're new to us,
and we're new to you,
make sure you scroll down,
hit that subscribe button,
and turn on the post notification bell,
because we're on the road to 200K.
And we cannot get there without you guys, all right? Join the family. Without further ado, let's get into the video.
여러분 안녕하십니까? 오늘 특별한 손님을 모시고 왔습니다. 제 어머니입니다. Come on in, mom. 엄마, 아, 자기 소개 부탁합니다.
아, 안녕하세요. 저는 폴 엄마입니다.
That's it. We've reached the last and final country of my own personal heritage, so I figured why not go out with a bang and bring my own mom on the show. You're gonna love her, and if you don't, I'll basically kill you.
He said, forget YouTube at this point.
Geography. For the record, yes, my mom speaks English, and whenever she comes on screen, we'll most likely speak Konglish with each other, since my Korean skill level is equivalent to a five-year-old that got electrocuted in the brain. Nonetheless, that's okay! This episode will be a piece of chapsaltok. Let's begin. Now, if you haven't already seen the North Korea episode, I suggest you do, because it covers some of the context you'll need for this episode. Anywho, first of all, South Korea makes up the bottom half of the Korean Peninsula in East Asia, located between the Yellow Sea, the Gyeonggi Bay, the Jeju Strait, and the Korea Strait off Japan's Tsushima Island. And this thing, which, be careful what you call it, the Chinese and Koreans call it the East Sea, whereas the Japanese and others might call it the Sea of Japan. The country is divided into 8 provinces, 6 metropolitan cities that act as their own entities, a special self-governing province, Jeju-do Island, and the capital Seoul, that has the title of Special City, acting as its own entity as well. Then you have this weird thing, Sejong, a special autonomous city. Back in 2007, the government was like, crap, we have too many people here in Seoul.
Yeah, half the country lives here. We need to move some people out.
That's actually a good idea, but how do we make them move?
Why don't we move the government buildings and make a second capital? We could also incentivize people to move in. Kind of work with Brazil.
Great! But you first. So now, technically, South Korea has 2 capitals. Psh, back in my day, there were only 8 provinces, with Jeju-do and Seoul was the capital. 한국 왜 이렇게 복잡하게 하는 거지? South Korea owns and administers over 3,500 islands off its coasts, the largest one being Jeju-do, which is kind of like the Hawaii of Korea. You know what's really strange? If South Korea was an island, it would look eerily similar to the shape of Ireland. Anyway, as we mentioned in the North Korea episode, South Korea has a border with their brothers up north at the DMZ, or Demilitarized Zone, patrolled by over 2 million people at any given moment. In addition, there are 4 known tunnels that have been built underneath the border, including what South Korea calls the third tunnel of aggression. Basically, in 1978, it went down like this. Oh, what the? Why is there a tunnel under my... Oh, no. Hey, UN, North Korea built this as an act of aggression.
No, it's a coal mine.
There's no coal here. It's all granite and igneous rock. And what about those other 3 tunnels we discovered?
Clearly, we were looking for coal in other places because it wasn't here.
Today, it's a tourist spot heavily guarded by South Korean troops. There are suspected to be possibly around 20 more tunnels, but info on that is classified. Otherwise, South Korea has 11 UNESCO World Heritage Sites, the Baekje Mounds, these dolmen sites, Changdeokgung Palace, Gyeongju Historic Village, Haeinsa Temple, Andonghwahae Maul, Hwasong Fortress, the Jongmyo Shrine, Namansansong Fortress City, the Royal Tombs of the Joseon Dynasty, and Bulguksa Temple. Otherwise, some other notable spots of interest might include places like Everland, Korea's largest theme park, and Lotte World, the world's largest indoor theme park, Gyeongbokgung Palace, Seoul Tower, the War Memorial, Lotte Tower, the tallest building in the peninsula and 5th in the world, the National Museum, Dongdaemun Market, Busan's Fish Market, Daegu's Arboretum, the Thermal Springs of Wonju. Mom, what's your favorite place to visit? Seoul Tower, the War Memorial, Lotte Tower, the tallest building in the peninsula and 5th in the world, the National Museum, Dongdaemun Market, Busan's Fish Market.
Yeah.
Somebody tell me that slugs are just some seashells that they collected.
Well, I mean, it's a fish market, babe, so it's food.
Clam?
I don't know. It's all like,
it look like
colors
slugs.
Are
yeah.
All together.
I don't know.
Daegu's Arboretum, the Thermal Springs of Wonju. Mom, what's your favorite place to visit in Korea?
Maybe you can go to the Gangwon-do. Interesting place, so you can see that.
And the list goes on and on. Just like Japan, there are too many quirky, interesting, colorful sites to list. Alas, we must move on. If you go to South Korea, you'll notice that the countryside is actually very picturesque, if you can get all the tacky apartment buildings out of the way from your view. First of all, cradled away in the docile Amurian Plate, Japan and China take up most of the heavy earthquakes, tsunamis, and typhoons, so they don't really experience anything too crazy in terms of natural catastrophe. Around 80% of the country is mountainous. They share the same Taebaek mountain chain with North Korea. The longest river is the Nakdong that flows all the way from the mountain chain into the East Sea along Busan. They don't really have a lot of big lakes, the largest one being Chungju, artificially created by a dam. Since North Korea took Mount Paektu, South Korea's highest point, switched to Mount Hallasan, a shield volcano located on Jeju Island. It last erupted over 1,000 years ago. This makes Jeju Island a unique place from the rest of Korea, with famous lava tube caves, Sunrise Peak, and the Dragon Head Coast. In Boryeong, you have the famous mud flats that holds a festival every year that draws in over 2 million visitors. Bolsong is famous for their tea fields. The problem is that summers are so incredibly humid and filled with mosquitoes. Mom, do you remember when I was a kid, they made me camp in the Yeongdong pine fields, and it was like, oh, it's so terrible. They made me brush my teeth and, like, bathe in the river, and the bathrooms were just holes in the ground.
Yes, I remember. I've never been there, but I heard all kind of terrible story about that.
Oh, and every year between winter and spring, they experience Hwangsa, the yellow dust season, in which dust particles from the Gobi Desert are swept up by fast winds and cover all of East China and the Koreas, sometimes even as far as Japan and parts of Russia. This is the reason why you see so many Asians wearing those surgical masks, like, every year. Now, in the North Korea episode, I discussed a list of notable Korean dishes. I'm not gonna do it again, but as you know, kimchi is the national dish. 그런데 우리 어머니가 김치 만드는 법을 가르쳐 주겠습니다.
첫째, 소금물에 배추를 절이고, 둘째, 절여주는 동안에 양념을 만드는 고춧가루, 마늘, 생강 갈은 것, 그리고 설탕, 젓갈이 필요합니다. 모든 것을 잘 믹스하여 놓은 동안에 절여진 배추를 꺼내서 깨끗하게 씻고 먹기 좋은 사이즈로 잘라서 준비해 놓은 양념으로 버무려서 싱싱한 것을 먹고 싶으면 그냥 먹고 아니면은 2, 3일 동안 두었다가 약간 익었을 때 먹으면 맛있습니다.
Now keep in mind there are hundreds of different types of kimchi out there, but cabbage is the most popular one. 근데 깍두기 나야 제일 좋아하는 김치예요. Mom.
So you seen all those ingredients. Does it sound difficult to make?
Very easy.
Very easy?
You wanna try it?
No, I'm about to say this video gets a certain amount of likes, we can get you to make it.
Oh, he have a challenge.
I say if, I even put a number out there because I kind of was playing with the words a little bit.
Well, what's the challenge? They need to know.
If they can get this vid to a certain amount of likes, which I don't know yet, then I'll get all those ingredients for you. You can whip it up.
Okay, babe.
All right.
What's your favorite kimchi?
나는 내가 어릴 때 해주던 할머니가 해주던 백김치가 제일 좋습니다.
백김치, yeah. 고추장 안 나오는 김치네요.
고춧가루 안 넣고 하얗게 똑같은 재료로 버무린데 고춧가루만 빠진 김치예요.
Ah, okay, yeah, that's a good one. Oh, and one dish that's kind of unique to South Korea as opposed to North Korea is that they kind of like to eat sannakji sometimes, live squirming octopus dipped in hot sauce. They also like to eat live spoon worms. Trust me though, that's kind of tame compared to some regions in China. Economy-wise though, South Korea is all about the tech industry. Some of their largest companies being LG, Lotte, SK Group, Daewoo, Hanjin, Kia, and the crowning glories, Samsung and Hyundai. Today, South Korea is the fifth largest export in the world with the G20's largest budget surplus. It also has the world's eighth highest medium household income, highest in Asia, and it also has the highest credit rating out of any country in East Asia. As of 2015, they achieved the title of being the world's largest shipbuilder at over 2 million in gross tonnage, about 41% of the world's total. On top of that, in 2005, they became the world's first country to fully transition into high-speed internet. South Korea takes tech very seriously, and it exudes through the people's lives every day in a very interesting way. I mean, they even have their own robot prison guard. This means we gotta take it over too. Koreans are kind of like sponges. When they see something they like, they watch it, they observe it, they imitate it, they memorize it, they recreate it, master it, and obsess over it. This can be both a good and bad thing depending on what we're talking about. First of all, South Korea has about 51 million people and has the highest percentage of adults 25 to 34 years old that have tertiary education degrees. The country is almost completely homogenous at about 96% ethnically Korean, whereas the remaining 4% are made up of a number of foreigners, mostly being Chinese, Americans, and Vietnamese. They also use the South Korean won as their currency, they use the Type-C plug outlet, and they drive on the right side of the road. Now, without even really having to explain that much, I'm pretty sure you're all aware of how incredibly different South Koreans are from their brothers up north. In fact, on average, South Koreans are about 2 inches or 5 centimeters taller than the North Koreans due to their access to healthier and more diverse food options. South Korea, no surprise, speaks Korean, which is not only unique because there aren't really any languages related to it. Some might say Japanese is like a way distant cousin, but But also because of the writing system. Back in the 1400s, Sejong the Great was like, dude, I'm sick of the Chinese characters. It's too hard. Can we just make new ones? So they did. Today, Hangul, or as the North Koreans call it, Chosungul, is a phonetic alphabet that is incredibly easy to learn. It literally only takes like an hour for anybody to learn it. I mean, this letter makes a N sound, and this makes an A sound, and so on. The strange thing, though, is that Hangul is the only writing system in the world that uses syllable clusters. So in order to write, you kind of have to smash either two or three letters into a box format that goes either two across and one at the bottom, or three all the way down. So for example, the word for foot is bal. So you'd have to take the B sound next to the A sound and the U sound, making bal. And that's it. That's like 90% of the writing. Box smashing. The problem, though, is that speaking Korean is a nightmare. The grammar is all backwards. There's like subject indicators and possessive prefixes. There's 높은 말, 동갑 말, 낮은 말. 엄마, 나의 한국어 수준 어때요? 어떻게 생각합니까?
뭐, 이제 4살, 5살 애기 수준이지.
Now, I already explained the early history of the Korean Peninsula in the North Korea episode, so check it out if you want a summary. Basically, after the Korean War, the two Koreas that diverged buried the rest of the Korea. Essentially, unlike their brothers up north, South Korea became a democratic presidential republic, adopting a capitalistic model for their economy, with free market enterprise encouraging a competitive private sector. This did wonders for them. Today, they are classified as one of the four Asian tigers, along with Hong Kong, Singapore, and Taiwan, meaning that they have grown at an economic rate over 10% annually over the past 30 years. Remember the Germany episode we talked about the Wirtschaftswunder? Yeah, they basically did the same thing. After war times, they started working really hard. Just Google Miracle on the Han River. After the war, most of the Americans left, but they still kept some army bases with soldiers in places like Gyeonggi-do, where my dad was born, and Daegu, where my mom was born. Anyway, South Korea is a place where the future is embraced, but the past is never let go of. Traditional dances like the colorful Choyongmu and Talchum mask dances. If you're lucky to witness it, the long ribbon-spinning Pungmul dance can be seen in certain areas. Jultagi tightrope performers, and Namsadang acrobatics, where people launch high from seesaws. Also, the amazing traditional raspy-voiced pansori singing has never gone out of style. Usually, it's accompanied by these drums. Book, right, Mom? Book. Mm-hmm. And what is this one called?
Janggu.
Like that. Taekwondo and Hapkido are the two national martial arts. No surprise, South Korea ranks number one in the Olympics. Most Koreans at some point will probably learn at least a little bit of Taekwondo. I took it as a kid. And Mom, you took it too, right? You took Taekwondo when you were younger?
Yeah, when I was in high school.
You were like the only girl in your class, right? Mm-hmm. How many boys were in your class?
Oh, 50, 60.
And what belt did you get up to?
Black belt.
So yeah, basically my mom can kill your mom.
Why do I have to kill you?
Speaking of martial arts, South Korea is a conscription country with all men required to serve in the military anywhere between the ages of 18 to 35 for about 2 years. Women are allowed to volunteer too if they wish. Most Koreans still get married in the Jeontong Yeshik traditional Hanbok style wedding. And there's also a part where like the bride's family and friends have to like beat the husband's feet for some reason. Mom, why do they do that? Why do they like beat the man's feet during the wedding?
Maybe punishing him to take away from their daughter.
So they're like punishing him like, oh, it's payback for all the pain you...
Was that in Zambia where they did that, or South Africa?
I know exactly what you're talking about. Yeah, they covered them and everything.
Yeah.
With the blankets.
One of the ethnic groups. Yes, I think it was South Africa.
I don't remember.
Because they were playing a lot.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think it was South Africa. I forgot which tribe it was. Mm-hmm. But y'all let us know if y'all know what we're talking about. What are some other like cultural traditional things that y'all think may be interesting or like a shocker to us?
Mm-hmm.
We would love to dive deeper into that, you know?
Will give me. So much. Fun side note, people usually try to avoid marrying someone with the same last name as them in South Korea. The problem is that only three last names make up about half of the entire population. Kim, Lee, and Park. Today, numbers are a little hard to estimate, but many will say that about a third of the country identifies as Christian, mostly Protestant branches, along with a sizable Buddhist community at maybe 20%, whereas the rest claim to vaguely follow ancient traditional Korean-style Confucianism, the indigenous shamanism, or no affiliation at all. In fact, after the US, South Korea sends more Christian missionaries abroad than any other country in the world. Otherwise, tradition aside, Koreans have glided ever so stealthily into the modern world. Today, South Korea has a huge esports industry, and gamers are celebrities. They can make millions. Of course, this can also lead to some problems, as some people have been known to have died by playing nonstop or actually killing people, or getting arrested for neglecting their children in favor of playing video games. Coincidentally, one where you have to raise an online virtual baby. I'm not even joking, that's a true story. Look it up. Like the Japanese, Koreans love their norebangs, moryeoktangs, and jimjilbangs. However, the difference is that Koreans usually don't cover themselves with towels, they just go butt naked. I like your style. South Koreans also have disputably the highest percentage of plastic surgeries performed per capita in the world at around 20 per thousand residents. The most popular one, mostly for women, being the double eyelid surgery, in which they add a fold to their eyelids as it's seen as more attractive. Parents even usually give their daughters the surgery as a graduation gift. 엄마, 왜 한국 여인들은 쌍꺼풀 수술을 하는 것을 예쁘다고 생각하니까?
왜, 넌 안 예쁘니?
No, I mean like, kind of, but like sometimes, like, 내 생각은 수술한 여자 애기는, like when they come out, they're gonna have like the wekapur, so it's like 수술도 계속 해야 돼요 for like every generation.
People thinking about the beauty is getting changed.
Oh, yeah, but you can't change your genetics. In terms of controversies, South Koreans usually rank in the top 10 or even 5 countries with the highest suicide rates. Honor culture is so high that sometimes it affects people that don't feel like they meet societal expectations. Students have some of the highest stress levels in the world. Many go to hagwons after school, which is like another special school. You can go to school after school for more school, and it ends at like 10 p.m. Students get like no sleep. And finally, unfortunately, sometimes Koreans can be a little discriminatory against non-Koreans. As a homogenous nation with no real minority experience prior to the 20th century, you might find shockingly racist depictions of certain people groups that everyone is just kind of comfortable with. Sometimes they even put up signs saying no foreigners. They are just starting to kind of move on from that, but it's kind of still there. Anyway, there are so many things I wish I could talk more about, like how Koreans use the Korean age system. They ask for your blood type because it's like a horoscope sign type of thing. The festivals of Chuseok and Seonnal. There's still like a surviving heir to the former emperor that exists today. Jeju Island has those diving women. Arirang is like the national song that everybody knows. K-pop and K-dramas have taken the world K-pop by storm. Usually K-dramas are accompanied with strange or horribly translated subtitles with the worst commercial interruptions. Changmia, 당신은 사랑해. 왜 그렇게 하니? 오빠, 저는 이미 결혼해. 여러분, 보부 세게트 커피 신발을 매우 편안합니다. 오, 지금 싸! Otherwise, some famous Koreans throughout history might include people like Lee Sun-shin, Kim Gu, Yu Kwan-sun, Kim Dae-jung, Ban Ki-moon, Song Chang-sik, Jo Young-nam, Lee Seung-man, Park Jung-hee, Park Ji-sung, Park Tae-hwan, Kim Yuna. Actors like Park Bo-geum, Song Joong-ki, Kim Yoo-jung, Song Hye-kyo. Contemporary K-pop artists like H.O.T, B and BoA, Girls' Generation, Super Junior, AOA, Big Bang, 21, EXO. Tons of Americans with Korean heritage have also made the mark, like John Cho, Randall Park, Kim Jong, Victor Barbato, and the list goes on and on. South Korea went from a war-torn shanty peninsula to a world-renowned power player, and it all had to do with their international outreach. This brings us to our last and final section, the...
Alright, time for our guessing.
Gotta see what the relationship is with China and Japan on that one.
Japan?
Yeah, it was Japan.
What Japan?
Japan.
Where?
On side of South Korea.
Oh. Okay, I believe America is their best race.
Yeah.
That's what I believe. That's what I'm gonna stick with.
Yeah, I don't think we're gonna put too much in the basket on this one.
Yeah.
Yeah.
South Korea has always kind of had to prove itself against not only their neighbors, but to their own brothers up north to show that they could become something great apart from the political divergence factor. First of all, South Korea has great ties to the European Union as they make up the second largest export partner. Tourism has exploded since the 80s and 90s, and many Koreans study abroad in Europe for college semesters. Japan is like their best frenemy. Although the Koreans loved watching the Japanese being deposed after World War II, it wasn't long until they had their own problems in the Korean War. After the war, the Japanese befriended the South, and since then, relations have gotten much better. Koreans admit they can't get enough of Japanese anime, J-pop, and they do like the colorful culture and cuisine as they make one of the largest groups that visit annually. The Philippines was one of the first friends that they had even before this split. They even sent their expeditionary force to help against North Korean invasions during war times. For some weird reason, if you put a Filipino and a Korean together, they just kind of like immediately click and get each other. I mean, why do you think I hired Ken?
Aw, thanks, man.
Yeah, I guess you're all right, kind of.
Does that mean I get to co-star in the Philippines episode?
Yeah, if you can actually edit the video on time and not ruin it by slacking off, yes you can! In terms of their close friends, Koreans would probably say China and kind of the US. Both countries host the largest numbers of Koreans in diaspora at around 2.5 million each, and both are the largest export partners. China kind of acts as like the mediator friend between them and North Korea, and they struggled alongside them during the Japanese Empire occupation years, in which both were required to speak Japanese and throw away their customs for like three decades. Like my mom's mom, my grandma. Mom, didn't you say like your mom spoke Japanese with your stepdad or something like that?
Yeah, they spoke with Japanese all the time when I was little. They were educated with Japanese when Japanese occupied Korea.
But they never spoke Japanese to you?
Because I don't know Japanese and then they were kept secret.
They kept a secret for the secret language
for the children, for children.
Kind of like what you and Dad did with me in Korean.
Yeah,
yeah. Something like that.
They had a secret language.
That's very smart.
The US played a major role during the Korean War and has a mutual defense treaty, meaning that any attack on South Korea would summon an immediate US response. Of course, the US still has military bases located in the country, which of course brings in some anti-American protests since many are kind of weary of the US presence. Nonetheless, Barack Obama is even quoted for saying that South Korea is one of the US's closest allies and greatest friends, as they have shared so much over the past seven decades. When it comes to North Korea, though, they kind of see him as like the brother that stubbornly thinks he can still make a point that was lost like 70 years ago. They want to unify, but just one man kind of stands in the way. South Koreans have been trying to sneak propaganda into North Korea by hurling DVDs and USB sticks and gifts and other such items via balloon across the border. They figure the best way to reunify is to expose North Korea to how great the outside world is. In conclusion, although millennia of kingdoms and empires have passed, much of South Korea's global story starts after the Korean War. This little peninsula has been able to create a supernova of recognition for itself in such a short amount of time. Let's hope that the future brings even more light to the world. Thank you, Mom, for helping me in this episode.
Thank you for inviting me here.
Mm-hmm.
I really appreciate it.
Do you really?
I'm honored of that.
Do you really appreciate it? Are you just saying that?
Got
it. Stay tuned. Kyrgyzstan is coming up next.
It was fire, bro. Awesome, man, to see his mom on the channel like that. I think that's lovely.
Yeah.
100%. This was very informative. Learned a lot. You know, got to sit back and listen to a lot. Sometimes we know some things, and he explained it perfectly and plainly.
As always, man. You know, sometimes we just got to be a sponge. Got to take all this information in. You know what I'm saying? But you guys can also inform us on things. Yeah, I asked a question earlier. Is there any other things that you guys think that we would like in the culture shocks and stuff like that? Also, we have our description box open where you can send requests about South Korea if you want to check out videos that way as well, too.
So we hope you guys enjoy this video with us. Like this video, subscribe, turn on the post notification bell. We have enabled our
super thanks
if you like to support the channel that way, as well as our reaction request forms in our description box below. We'll see you soon.
Peace.